Welcome to the Winged Wheel Podcast. Here to talk all things hockey are your hosts, Brad Crisco, Ryan Hanna, and Evan Lobsinger.
I shouldn't have expected anything different at all. Knowing how these playoffs have gone with reviews and knowing how pretty much any time there's an argument where you and I say we can't have this argument because at the end of this podcast, I need to hit, you know, end recording and you need to leave my house without us beating each other to a pulp. And I should have known that as soon as we've taken that stance, what would the universe give us besides one of the most controversial offside reviews and subsequent calls that we have seen in recent NHL history? I've received probably like four or five DMs from friends and people who I talk hockey with who I actually like, unlike you. And for legal purposes, that's a joke. Relax. You know who you are. All of them ended with like straight, most of them ended with like straight vitriol. Like, if you disagree, I'll stab you. I will find you and stab you. And I'm like, wow. Well, it looks like we're going to have to talk about this on tomorrow's podcast. You ready for that?
I'm always ready. Because, see, the difference between me and you is I don't read the comments. I don't care what people think of my opinion because I'm never going to know.
I don't know what's wrong with me. Because I say out loud. I say and I truly believe, yeah, I don't care what, like, you know, not everyone's going to like everything we do. And that's part of, you know, growing. We have more listeners, whatever. There's no way everyone's going to like everything we do. And I accept that. And I really do. And like, to my core, I really do. But every time I go and read the comments, and honestly, I've gotten to the point where some of like there's just straight up mean stuff I just laugh at straight. I've found a way to laugh at. I've taken a lot actually from Frege in that respect. He just takes it in stride. His tweet yesterday was, once again, I thank you all for your kind DMs. I laughed my ass off when I saw that. But there's absolutely no way I'm not going to read them. And that's a big problem. I probably need to see that, like have that addressed by a professional at some point.
Yeah. It's just comment, something derogatory. Yeah, whatever. Someone questioning your intelligence. Whatever. This three paragraph long, well-reasoned explanation about why you're wrong. Screw that guy.
The funny part is you're not kidding. It's times like this where, okay, first of all, I miss Red Wings playoff hockey more than anything. Yesterday was 20 years ago to the day of Game 7 of the 2002 Western Conference Final against Colorado. The 7-0 rout of the Avalanche where they chased Patrick Waugh. They sang na-na-na-na in the stands. Like, iconic. That's one of the best playoff series of all time. I would give almost anything to have that back. But I have to tell you right now, as a neutral observer, I feel safe. I feel like I can go to bed happy. It is a small reprieve from what I know Oilers fans and Avalanche fans and teams in the playoffs, their fans are going through. It'll be us again one day.
Can't wait.
Welcome to the Winged Wheel Podcast, folks. Here to talk to you about all things Detroit Red Wings, NHL, and the world of hockey. I am one of your hosts sitting in Evan Lobsinger's spot, Ryan Hanna.
And I'm Evan.
No, bad Brad. Because some people listen audio only and they think we sound similar. And I say, well,
no, because I have to give an opinion about offside and offside reviews today. So I, Evan, would like to receive direct feedback from everybody who disagrees with me at my Twitter handle at HockeytownEvan.
Yeah, the way you can tell mine and Brad's voices apart are the bad opinions. If you hear a bad opinion, that's Brad. That's the difference in our voice. That's the different cadence. On this episode of the Winged Wheel Podcast, there actually is some Red Wings news in terms of prospects that were left to be free from the Red Wings pipeline. An incoming ELC, possibly, for the towering behemoth, so named by Large. And a player I want to talk about, a centerman who might not be qualified by Chicago, who could fill in Detroit's middle center depth. I'm not talking about last year's Pugh Suter, believe it or not. We have our first mock draft of the year with our good friend Max Bultman of the Athletic Detroit. So we did a 16-pick mock draft of all the non-playoff teams.
I can't believe how far he went off the board for Detroit's pick.
It was really weird that he tried to draft Bowen Byram
again.
Again. But no, actually, I was the clown for this mock draft. I'm the one who messed up that many times. It was bad. And then we are going to chat a little bit about the playoffs, talk about that offside review before going into overtime, provided that we survive the offside review conversation. Mm-hmm. Before that, I want to tell everyone about the Jamie Daniels Foundation and the work that you have helped us do to raise money for the Jamie Daniels Foundation over the past season. You have helped us raise over $29,000. We're close to our stretch goal of $30,000 from the start of the 2021-2022 season until now through the Wings Money on the Board campaign. And that was started in partnership with our good friend Prashant Iyer. So thank you so very much for that. Once the Calder Trophy is announced, I know a lot more of you are going to be making pledges and donations, and then we're hoping to hit that stretch goal. So really, really excited. And we really encourage you to visit jamiedanielsfoundation.org to learn more and offer your support. They're doing really fantastic work. There's a lot of great stuff coming up on their end, which we'll talk about shortly. Speaking of Prashant Iyer, the If I Were Steve Yzerman series part 3 will be released. Depending on when you're listening to this, it might be out. But as of Thursday morning, that will be out and live for everyone on the WingedWheelPodcast.com blog. Once it's up, I will edit the description of this episode to include the link. Go give it a read. It is everything draft. It includes rankings. It includes draft strategies, trading up, trading down, things like that. A really, really comprehensive look at the top prospects that will likely be available to the Red Wings at 8th overall. Okay. Why don't we start with the Detroit Red Wings, who, as of today, have decided to not offer contracts and thus forfeited the exclusive signing rights to the following prospects. Otto Kivenmáki, who is the 191st overall pick, round 7 in the 2018 draft. Jesper Eliasson, third round pick in the 2018 draft, 84th overall. And Alex Cotton, fifth round pick, 132nd overall in the 2020 NHL draft. So Kivenmáki is a center slash forward. Eliasson is a goaltender, and Alex Cotton is a defenseman. Kivenmáki and Eliasson will be eligible as UFAs, and Alex Cotton is eligible to actually re-enter the draft. So that's the gist of it without getting into the nitty-gritty details. In terms of the prospects lost here, I have to say Eliasson isn't a surprise. He's one of the goalie darts that the Red Wings have thrown and will continue to throw and just didn't pan out, and it shouldn't come as a shock. Otto Kivenmáki is, it's not statistically and just by watching his career progression, it's not a shock. But before that injury, you know, you had a little glimmer of hope for him.
He definitely outperformed his draft slot. The fact that he ended up on anybody's radar at all, let alone as many as he did, you know, seventh round picks are often afterthoughts within a year of being drafted. He showed a hell of a lot of improvement, especially for being up 5'9", 112-pound forward. But the problem is when you're like that, you can't just be above average.
Yeah.
You have to be elite. And he never got close to that. But he gave it a good run. You know, the injury sucked and it was scary. And obviously we're happy that he's back playing hockey again. But yeah, he just didn't have the high-end tools to overcome his deficiencies, even though he definitely overachieved relative to where he was drafted.
At 191st overall, you take a swing on those guys who would potentially have that high-end skill, and if you could have guaranteed it, they wouldn't be 191st overall pick, so I have no problem with that dart. Eliasson, that third-round pick, you'd like to see a little bit better come of a third-round pick. I know Prashant would be the first to say this is why you don't spend really high draft stock on a goaltender. It's a third round pick. It's not the end of the world still. It's from 2018. It wasn't the best draft.
That draft's shaping up to be all right for the Red Wings anyway. They might have three legit NHL players out of that draft, which is always a success.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the third round after where Eliasson was picked, because they took Alec Regula, they took Seth Barton, and then they took Jesper Eliasson with the third of that. So I understand why.
Yeah.
You have three third-round picks, you take a crack. But for the people who went behind him, there wasn't really too much. Like, when I say it wasn't the best draft, there wasn't too much behind him where you're like, oh, there's an obvious pick right there of a guy who panned out. So Alex Cotton, a little bit more recent, just 2020 fifth-round pick.
Drafted as an overager, though. That was his second time eligible for the draft.
And he was a high producing offensive defenseman. And even this past season with the Vancouver Giants and the Dub, you know, 32 points in 46 games, 16 points in 12 playoff games. The numbers are there, but there's questions about They identified a lack of ability in terms of skating and in terms of play in the defensive zone. Hasn't really been one of the premier Red Wings defensive prospects. So it kind of just is what it is there.
Yeah. I mean, he was an overager in the WHL this year too, which for an offensive defenseman as an overager, those numbers, while good, weren't anything special, especially in the regular season. You would hope to see more because he's what, 21 already or close to it.
Yeah, he just turned 21 about just under a month ago.
Yeah, exactly. So an offensive defenseman as an overager in the CHL should be over a point per game. He was a late bloomer to begin with. So in terms of his overall career trajectory, he'll probably land in a pretty decent pro league. And that's fantastic for him because in his draft year, that probably didn't look like it was going to happen.
Right.
So for Alex Cotton, the person, he's still batting where above he probably should have been 3 years ago. So it's still a good story, but in terms of his NHL prospects, yeah, there really isn't much, if any.
These are all, and if this is sounding foreign to you, just know that this kind of thing happens cyclically. Some years you have more players expiring than others. Essentially, there comes a point where you have to make a decision with players. Are they moving up through your system? Are you trading them out? Are you signing them? Or do you have to make room just by letting them go because you have another draft? Every year there's a draft and you have to bring those players in and there needs to be room for them. So it's just pruning.
There are contract limits and only so many roster spots available.
Yeah. Speaking of contracts, Elmer Söderblom yet to sign his ELC, but rumored to be coming. So Frölunda has all but given up on the hope of the big man returning over there. So we can probably expect something on the front of Elmer Söderblom and his entry level contract soon. Where do you think he ends up?
Probably Grand Rapids.
That's the safe answer, but that's not the fun answer, Brad.
It's not the fun answer.
Don't let the truth get in the way of some fun.
Hey, they are the Red Wings, usually one of the more injury prone teams in the league. We could see a midseason call up if he performs well. For all his talent, he still has quite a few things to elevate in his game in order to play at the NHL level, but he seems to have the important things figured out. So it's probably more refining than changing who he is as a player, which is always a very, very positive sign. Smaller ice, you know, quicker pace. It's the traditional typical stuff that everybody preaches and always sounds repetitive. And honestly, it gets
us repetitive.
But we say it so often because it is relevant almost universally to European prospects, especially guys who, like Söderblom, who went into the draft as a very, very raw prospect who had a lot to work on. But obviously, like, the tools were there and the Red Wings were hoping, hey, if this guy ever puts it together, holy hell, you might have something here. And as luck would have it, it seems like he's put it all together, but doesn't mean it's fully there yet. Very close. Very, very close, but I think he'd benefit greatly from a year in Grand Rapids.
From the moment he was drafted until now, he's done nothing but impress and show that was it? Yeah, 159th overall, sixth round pick in 2019 was well worth it. We called him at the time, those who have been listening for a while, you remember, he's a project pick. He's a weird combination of some really unique skills where if they come together in the right way, you have a little bit of a unicorn. And sure, that might be a third, fourth line player, or it could also be a first, second line player. It could be a guy who slots in confidently on your power play. It could be a guy who makes a difference in a game more regularly than not. And with a sixth round pick, 159th overall, that's amazing. For a guy who is that big, you said he needs to elevate parts of his game. His height's not...
No, adequate.
He is a monster. He's huge. And the way he stick handles and controls the puck, especially in tight, you'd think he was Otto Kivenmáki, who we just talked about, who's like 5'7", 5'8", at best. So, yeah, he's been fun to watch, and it is not a bad thing. I joked earlier, like, don't let the truth get in the good way of some fun. It will still be fun if and likely when Elmer Söderblom ends up in the AHL. I think Griffins fans deserve that because they thought they were going to have both Lucas Raymond and Moritz Seider this season. Well, not Seider, but at least Lucas Raymond, and they got neither of them. So, you know, they'll get Söderblom, and I think he'll do some damage down there.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
I want to talk about one player before we get into the mock draft. Dylan Strome, center for the Chicago Blackhawks, who are in a pretty unique cap situation. We talk about this in the mock draft coming up, but they're essentially recovering from the previous administration's management.
Can't relate, not at all. Never been through a situation like this.
Asset management. Oh God, that pick. That if that pick turns into Yurecek, I'll lose my mind. That's so funny. But Dylan Strome is a player who might not see a qualifying offer. He's a restricted free agent for the Chicago Blackhawks. And for those of you who don't know, long story short, to retain the rights to your restricted free agents, you need to tender a qualifying offer. And in the interest of saving cap and managing the roster, Dylan Strome might not get one. He plays center. He's 25 years old. What is it? Last season in 69 games, he had 48 points. You look up his underlying numbers, his impacts on the ice are solid. Is this another situation where the Chicago Blackhawks might leave a solid NHL roster centerman unqualified and thus open to free agency and the Red Wings pick him up, much like they did with Pew Suter last year?
Yes.
Would you do it?
Yes. But I don't think it'll happen for Detroit.
How come?
One, I still think people overestimate how hard it is to, I don't know what the right word is here, finagle the cap for when it looks like you have no cap space, but teams always find ways. So if the Hawks want to keep Dylan Strome, they will find a way to keep Dylan Strome. But I would have said the same thing with Pew Suter as well. And these are the Hawks, a very poorly managed team as of late. But unlike Pew Suter, Dylan Strome has at least a 3 to 4 year track record of being half decent in the NHL. Pew Suter had 1 year of being okay in the NHL, so a lot of teams were like, there might not be anything there. I think we have a little more certainty with what Dylan Strome is as a player, which means he'll have more suitors. His price will go up. I'm not saying the Red Wings shouldn't do it. I'm not saying the Red Wings shouldn't do it aggressively. I'm just saying I think that with how responsible Steve Yzerman is with the cap, I wouldn't call the Red Wings the favorite to land him, but they are absolutely going to be one of the teams because Yzerman might throw a curveball. Let's not forget the option's still on the table for salary cap dumps, and I'm not saying this one's going to happen, but Yzerman likes cap dumps. He likes assets, and he likes reclamation projects, so it could make just as much sense, if not more sense, for Yzerman to call up a team like Calgary and go, you need cap space. You want to keep Johnny Gaudreau. What asset will you give us? And we'll give Sean Monahan a year to see what he can do. Like, there's options like that.
Yeah.
I'm using him as an example, but because if Dylan Strome gets 3 years at $5 million from someone, do the Red Wings do that? Probably not.
His qualifying offer would be $3.6 million from Chicago for context as to what ballpark he'd be in. And his previous salary was $3
million. And he's been consistently over half a point per game for the last 4 years. That's a pretty cheap price for a 40-point score.
Last season, he was just under and then over. Yeah, he actually has been. Last season was 17 points in 40 games, but that's about it. The season prior, 26 and 58, so close, just under 34 and 58 the season prior. And then in 2021, 2022, he had 48 points in 69 games. So he's a productive player. You're going to see, I would imagine you'd see similar-ish numbers. You're not going to see them skyrocket if he does end up on Detroit. Think about Pew Suter and what he did in Chicago compared to the Red Wings. I think he'd be walking onto a Red Wings team that's likely a little bit better than last year. He may have even more ice time. You know, Strome and Suter to take on that second and third line, whichever one wants to step up their center role behind Larkin as first line center. I don't mind that. It's not great. It's not cup competitive. It's likely not even, it's actually definitely not playoff competitive.
Yeah. Nothing says you want to win a cup right now, like just ripping off the Blackhawks.
Hey, they've had a few in their generation. They're just coming off that now.
Were Strome and Suter a part of those?
What did I say earlier about the truth, Brad?
Right.
We're running a podcast here. Okay. I'm always in favor of building in true. Why'd you just punch the wall?
I was stretching. I thought I had more clearance to bring my arm back around.
There's a short joke in here somewhere, but you're lucky I'm not clever enough to make it. I'm always in favor of bringing in centermen who can shelter Michael Rasmussen, i.e. put him on the wing. I'm always in favor of bringing in centermen to shelter injuries in the lineup, which happen every year, seemingly more than ever on the Red Wings. And so, you know, if Larkin goes down or Suter goes down, you still have a natural center to play, and you're not asking Joe Valeno to play first line center. I think it'd be great. I think you'd still make a good point, though. There are going to be suitors elsewhere. He's not a small name either. Dylan Strome was a third overall draft pick in 2015. People know his name. They're going to know his story. I'm sure, like you said, other GMs have their eyes on him. They're going to try to get him cheap. And why are you laughing? And I'm always worried it's about the damn monkey.
No, that could be back-to-back years of the Red Wings taking Arizona Coyotes first-round pick as a reclamation project. 2014, Brendan Perlino.
I forgot Perlino was a Coyotes. Was a Coyotes prospect. Between that and the ridiculous jokes that we were making before we hit record that we can't repeat, your brain is like the Homer Simpson thing where like you see what's going on in there. It's just the monkey with the with the symbol.
I told you how my night last night went, so
yeah,
it's very understandable.
Again, I don't know why it's so hard for you to have kids. I watched your kids and it was dead simple. I just think I'm way better at this. I can't even get it up straight face. Okay, folks, this has gone off the rails. Let's jump into this conversation that we had with Max Bultman of the Athletic Detroit, and just as importantly, good friend of the Winged Wheel podcast. So we did our first of the season mock draft, 16 picks, wherein I tried to assign Max the Red Wings pick, and I can't count backwards, apparently, so it ended up with Brad. So thank you, Max, for putting up with that, and enjoy this interview, everyone. So we started this recording, and it was 6-3, and it is now currently 7-4 in the Oilers-Avalanche game. So let's set the over-under at 13.5 goals.
Over.
Over.
Yeah, maybe I went too low there.
There's still 3 minutes left in the second.
I've seen the Oilers score 3 goals in a period like too many times this playoffs to take the under there.
And we just saw Colorado and St. Louis do this to end their last, well, not to end their last series, but that game that St. Louis won. Yeah, maybe that was set too low. We probably should have set it at like 15.5. Anyhow, we really do need to work on that cardboard cutout of Prashanth to join us, but welcome to the first of the season 2022 NHL entry mock draft featuring none other than Max Bultman. Max, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, always good to be here. Excited to see where this number ends up and sad to be missing it live.
You're guilting me, man. You're guilting me on air in front of the listeners. Yeah, Prashanth couldn't make it probably just because he's watching the game. So we are long overdue to start one of these, so appreciate Max coming back from vacation from beautiful Costa Rica you went to?
Puerto Rico.
Puerto Rico.
You got 3 letters right.
How was that?
It was really good. Oh, it was great. We hiked the rainforest. We kayaked 3 times. Obviously, did some pool sitting and all that good stuff. Tried the various, I think, pina colada was invented there, right? So I tried one of those from there.
Sure. Yeah. Nice. Well,
if it wasn't multiple different like people at touristy places claimed it was, so then it's just a scam.
You know what? I don't think I would happily take a pina colada from like Chatham, Ontario as well. Can't mess with those.
Yeah, no, like I actually, Allison and I were just talking about it though, because it's like, it's one of those drinks that if you order it at like any bar, the bartender like probably should have license to slap you because of how high maintenance they are to make. But if everyone there is claiming that it's invented there, it's kind of a free invitation to order it. So that's what we did.
Absolutely. Okay. So how do we usually do this to decide the order?
I think we just first decide who wants to make the Red Wings pick and then go from there.
You know what, Max? You just went through, what was it, 2,500 responses for your fan opinion survey?
I don't want to do it. How about that?
Well, that, much like President of the United States of America, that is the perfect sign that you are the right person for the job. So, Max, you are drafting 8th overall for the Red Wings. All right. And I have to do some quick math here, which means you're drafting
second.
Second. I'm going to give myself first because I think that's funny. So I get the easy pick. And Brad, you are going
to... Is it easy?
I think it's easy.
Okay. just some momentum.
This storyline always comes up a month before the draft. Every damn year. Remember when there was a thought Connor McDavid wasn't the first overall pick? Remember that month?
I remember that month. I was not following the league at that time.
Okay.
I remember that month.
I don't think that, like, obviously that was a ridiculous thing because it's Connor McDavid, but of all players to be chalked up against Connor McDavid that year, that was one hell of a second overall pick, right? Like, it's not like they were working with Dylan Strome possibly second overall there. Anyhow, I will be drafting for the Montreal Canadiens to start, Brad for the New Jersey Devils, and then Max for the Arizona Coyotes. Max, if you make the correct pick here, you actually win a season ticket to their 5,000 seat, less than 5,000 seat college arena. So good luck.
Can I hold you to that order? Because you just gave Brad the eighth pick spot.
Wait, did I?
Yeah. Whoever picks second is going to pick eighth.
Oh, I did. Yeah, no, that's fair. Brad, you're picking eighth.
Get him on the technicalities every time, ladies and gentlemen. If you take one thing away from this.
Oh, what a mess. Okay. 2022 NHL mock entry draft. For your sakes, we're going to get started. First overall for the Montreal Canadiens, they are not going to big brain this. I know there's an argument to be made for Juraj Slafkovský, and Max, I want to hear it from you in a second, but they are going to go with the centerman Shane Wright in the Bell Center in Montreal, and they're going to be happy about it.
I would pick Shane Wright too. I just think the argument is who's the more like absolutely dynamic player. It is Slafkovský. You could also say Cooley is more dynamic. Absolutely. But you know, to me, what does Montreal already have? It is a super smart, detailed two-way center who's probably not going to light up the score sheet to a crazy degree in Nick Suzuki. If you have two of those guys, awesome. Great. I would make that pick if I was their GM. But I just think there is an argument that the thing that they're missing more than anything else is a super explosive, do-it-all, 6'4 power forward winger. I think he's a winger pretty standardly, but still, I think it's an argument, but I would pick Shane Wright too.
Okay, am I off base here, Max? I know you cover prospects more regularly on your show with Corey at The Athletic. Shane Wright, is he not one of the, I don't know, most prominent players who seemingly was affected by that missed COVID year? Because we saw
absolutely, yeah.
I just really get the sense with Shane Wright. Like, I do think he's the bona fide number one pick here, but I do get the sense that in a couple of years, people will be looking back and thinking, we were really low on him, even though he went first overall.
Maybe. I mean, if he goes first, no one's going to say that they got, like, the question to me is, what is the offense going to be? Because I think that's what people expected to be higher in his draft year. I think his shot, can be the kind of weapon that, like, there's a world, absolutely a world, where he turns into a 40-goal scoring Selke finalist and then everybody shuts up forever. But if he ends up like a 30-goal, 70-point, like really good but not quite absolutely elite two-way guy, then I think people will make arguments about it, especially, like, we'll see what Cooley and Slafkovský do. But I'd pick him. Like, to me, it's just like you have such a clear idea. Number one centers are so hard to find. I think the comp Corey put on him in his ranking today was Mika Zibanejad. And while Mika Zibanejad may not scream first overall pick to a lot of people, if you take that player, you are going to be thrilled no matter what happens anywhere else in the draft because you have that player. And that's how I would look at it. Center's the hardest position to find and add cheaply. Just do it. But I'm just saying that the argument is, there are people out there who will say you should take the, you know, highest ceiling, et cetera, et cetera. That may be Shane Wright, but it also may be Juraj Slafkovský or Logan Cooley.
So what I think this might come down to, and I think it's going to be a fascinating discussion as we lead up to the draft, is because Shane Wright and similarly a lot of other players from the OHL in this draft missed that year, did they just miss a year of development? And it's never going to catch up and they just missed that year. So that's just lost forever. Or did it just delay their development? Should we treat Shane Wright's 17-year-old year closer to a 16-year-old year? Because that was his second season, which should have been his third season. And I don't know the answer. I don't have a super strong opinion on this, but I think that might be what the debate comes down to on what you think of him.
That's a great question. I mean, probably the best, thing you could look at to try and figure that out is how do players who like start playing later, how does it work for them, right? Because is the development about number of years on ice and reps and all that stuff? Or is it about, you know, the moldability that you have at certain ages? And we kind of know, you got, Ryan, you're smarter. You guys are both smarter than me. Like the neural pathways and stuff that you can build, right? Like it's supposed to be easier to learn a language when you're young than when you're 26. Yeah. Stuff like that. Like it could be something like that, right? You know what I mean?
Yeah. And it's not even just neural pathways, what your body can sustain and the kind of development that you have, the ease at which that development comes, your recovery. It's all just so much more. It's so much more ideal as they're around draft age and prior. Those are formative years. And I've used that phrase before. Parents will know the same kind of language when they talk about those years where their kids are like a sponge. Brad, you know that because I've been teaching Mika swear words while you've not been around.
Good luck keeping up with me on that one.
And it's not to say that it's impossible. Like once they lose that year, they're forever, you know, this decrepit, less than hockey prospect. Like Brad raised the question, we don't know the answer to it, but yeah, Max, you're not wrong. It's better to not miss that year, those years in that development, than to kind of go through what Shane Wright has done. He's on the back foot, as are his peers who went through the same treatment. Okay, Brad, number two for the New Jersey Devils, assuming Tom Fitzgerald hasn't traded away the pick like he has teased, who are you taking?
See, I see why Max gave away this draft slot, because not only do I get to be the lightning rod for whoever I pick for Detroit, I also get to be the lightning rod in the Slafkovský versus Cooley debate, which I'm sure nobody will have any strong opinions about. I try to not draft with a preference on position, best player available. I try to not draft based on team needs because, like most people point out and wisely say, you don't know what that team looks like in 2, 3, 4, 5 years when these players hit their stride. That being said, the more dynamic player in my mind of these two does play the premium positions. So if I'm New Jersey, I'm going Logan Cooley here.
That makes it easy for Arizona. I mean, they did already take a winger, you know, at the top last year. And so I'm sure they would have probably preferred that Cooley got to them. But I would have made the same pick Brad did. I really love Logan Cooley's game. I do put a premium on the position. So Slafkovský, though, easy choice here at number three.
See, that's really interesting. I don't disagree with the pick, Brad. I can't say that I would make the same one for the Devils. I haven't really thought about Slafkovský versus Cooley too much. But people are talking about Slafkovský. I think Corey actually had him ranked first.
Corey did. And, yeah. And honestly, like that is the thing with the Devils is having those two centers. Like, does that sway them to Slafkovský?
Yeah. Imagine Slafkovský paired up with any one of those, you know, high-end borderline elite centers, depending on how far you think Hughes is into his development. So certainly makes my pick easier. The Arizona Coyotes, though they may have preferred the center, will be happy to have Juraj Slafkovský out of Liga. And I think that is where... Is that your pick?
Yeah, and I already made it.
Where have you been, champ?
My God. What's wrong? Am I okay? This is like the third straight episode where I've just been nowhere. I think I'm going to go see the doctor tomorrow.
Did you miss that year of development?
I'd apologize, but I'm gonna do it again.
And there's a little spreadsheet that pick, my friend
Ryan takes. Sorry, go ahead.
There's a little spreadsheet that my friend Ryan made for us. Ryan, if you want to just use that, it can be a helpful little guide for you.
All right.
I think Bowen Byram would be a great pick here.
What a throwback.
Yeah, Max isn't kidding. The worst part is I did make a spreadsheet that we're all in right now to make things easier. Because I have been known to trip up on this in the past. I can't ever make fun of Evan again. Fourth overall for the Seattle Kraken. This is one where a couple months ago I might have had an easier time taking David Juracek. But I think I'm going to go with Simon Nemec here out of Slovakia, the right-handed defenseman. You just can't ignore what he's done and the kind of production he's had. And he doesn't have that daunting knee injury that Juracek has. I think he's going to be a little bit more of an attractive option for these teams. And again, my opinion has swayed and it might do so again, but right now I'm on Nemec for the Kraken.
I like that. I think we were just looking it up today, in our group chat, and, he had, I think it was the fifth highest scoring world championships, like men's world championships ever, by a U18 player, but like overall, and he's a defenseman. Like that's, extremely impressive, and he's obviously unprecedented scoring in the Slovakian men's league. And I think he's smart enough that he's not just like an offensive player. I think he's a two-way player. And so when you factor in that he has that offense, impressive.
All right. Before I say who's going next, if this is Brad with the Philadelphia Flyers, fifth overall. Brad, who are you going with?
Well, best player available, position be damned. So I don't even want to have the debate because he's clearly the pick here in my mind, regardless of where he settles. Most dynamic player on the board, Matt Savoy.
Oh, interesting. Okay. So you're going Matt Savoy. So he's not even coming close in your world to the Red Wings.
I'm screwing myself here on this one. Like, that's who I want Detroit to get at eight, but I like him so much, I can't justify passing up on him here, even though I'm tempted to go with Juracek, but it would have been between those two for me there.
I think Savoy is going to be on the board when Detroit picks.
I think I so agree. Too, based on everything that's coming out, and that has me excited, but I'm the shitty GM of the Philadelphia Flyers right now, and I like Matt Savoy.
Respect.
All right.
Then I guess Columbus is going to go with Juracek. Obviously, is this the Chicago pick, right?
Yeah, this is the Chicago pick.
So very convenient for them that in the trade that they traded away Seth Jones, they get their next right shot D of the future here, as well as having gotten Cole Sillinger last year. That trade looks like an absolute heist for the Blue Jackets. And I think getting their just one for one replacement for Seth Jones right here kind of cements that.
That trade was bad at the time and somehow has still aged even worse. That's got to even be even, like, more of a sting for Chicago to watch a defenseman of that caliber go off the board. It should be some kind of poetic justice, or it should be some kind of, you know, warning tale or cautionary tale to GMs in the future who want to make that kind of trade, but we know it's going to happen again. Anyhow, I'm not going to cry over bad moves that the Chicago Blackhawks make. Seventh overall for the Ottawa Senators. I'm Pierre Dorion, happy as can be, and I'm going to stroll up to the stage and take... It's tight because I think in talking to Prashanth and reading part three of his If I Were Steve Yzerman article, I see a big case for Marco Kasper here, but I'm going to go with Joachim Kemmel out of Liga for the Sens. I really like that pick for them. I would be surprised if Kemmel actually drops down to seven. I see him going maybe a few picks higher.
I think it's a good pick. I mean, I think I wonder what Ottawa, like, if they had their absolute, well, first of all, the answer might be trading it or something for an impact player right now. But I wonder if they could have their absolute choice, like what position and player do they want to be there? Because they have improved, I think, their back end, but it's, you know, Shabbat and Sanderson. Would they kind of prefer that Juracek got to them? Centers, they now kind of have Norris and Stützle. I don't think they're like center needy. I think they can kind of play this winger wise, and that's why I like this. Like, they don't need to worry too much about position. But I also know, like having drafted Tyler Boucher a year ago, like, it seems like the kind of thing where I could see them preferring the power game of like a Cutter Gauthier here too. And so it's an interesting, like, I think Kemmel's a tough player to play against, and he's a great scorer. Like, but it's an interesting, I would love to know who they, like, who's their ideal. Is it Juracek, do you think, or is it one of the wingers?
I wouldn't be surprised if they're hoping Matt Savoy is there.
That could be dynamic.
Super Ottawa talented, strikes fits me as a Connor Geeky destination.
Interesting.
Because of the kind of the big center dynamic.
Yep.
The two that they have
to flex to the wing.
Yeah. The two centers they have being kind of more like true offensive profile, not small, but not huge kind of thing situation. I can see that.
Yeah. Cause the beauty of drafting a center, beyond obviously the premium of having a center, and part of my thinking, even taking Cooley for New Jersey, is it is way easier to flex a center to wing if you have too many than it is to bring a winger to center. So if Ottawa brings in a Connor Geeky and he ends up being their 3C, great, problem solved. If they end up with like four great centers in the organization and they have to flex one of them to the wing, that's not a bad problem to have.
All right, Brad, you have the eighth overall pick. So for the purposes of this mock draft, you are selecting for the Detroit Red Wings, but Max, you and I will also chime in with who we take here. So Brad, take us away.
If anybody's been listening for the last 2 months, this pick should not come as a surprise to anybody. Every once in a while, fate will a line and you get a position of need with the guy you think is best player available, and he meets the criteria of what your GM looks for in a player. So with the 8th overall pick, the Detroit Red Wings are going to select Frank Naser.
I can't really disagree with that at all. I think there are other contenders on the board, but yeah, Frank Naser, like you said, Brad, that's a confluence of position of need, the kind of high-end skill that you'd hope to have at 8th overall, and man, it kind of works out really well for Detroit. I don't know. I can't argue there.
A Steve Yzerman must. He can play all three zones. He's super skilled. Obviously, Detroit needs as many of those as they can get. I know he's on the small side, and to a lot of people, that's not ideal. But if Frank Naser was 6'2", he wouldn't have made it to this pick. So, you know, best case scenario, you get a Braden Point. Worst case scenario, you get a real pain in the ass good 3C.
I think the other options really here that a lot of people will be thinking of are Marco Kasper, Brad Lambert, and one more that I suspect, Max, you might be want.
Well, I mean, I picked Cutter Gauthier for them in our staff mock, and that's what I would do here as well, though I it's not a lock that he can play center, and I think that's relevant. Like, but if the choice to me are between Kasper and Naser, you guys know I would lean toward Kasper, but I think they're both good picks. They're both good prospects. They both fit a lot of what the Red Wings are looking for. I wouldn't have a problem with any of those picks.
Same.
All right. For the Buffalo Sabres, I believe, are up next. Max, who are you taking?
Gauthier.
Cutter Gauthier, just like that. Okay, so Cutter Gauthier is a guy who we're going to revisit on the podcast, because I think the first time we talked about him, we came in a little low. And the more we've talked, and the more, you know, we've been going back and forth in the group chat, and I know Prashant has pulled up some really great stats on Gauthier, much like Kasper, I think, where his underlying numbers might surprise people. He's kind of coming in under the radar.
No, and I think that's going to be similar to kind of like the Mason McTavish effect last year, or the Jake Sanderson 2 years ago. Like, I think just the closer the draft gets, people are going to get more comfortable with the idea that I think he's going to go in this range, if not sooner. But yeah, like I was similar to you guys. Like, by midseason, I think my first live look at him was sometime around the BioSteel game. Might have even been, well, I mean, I obviously saw him in his underage year, but the BioSteel game, he was really good. He scored a great shot. And then I saw him another game and was like, okay, like, he's a good player, and just it built and built. And the thing I was hesitant on was, is he just like a north south skate and shoot the puck big guy? And if that's the case, then to me, that guy should go around, you know, early teens or whatever. But I just kind of became more convinced that there was more offense there. And, you know, Corey and I have talked about it on the podcast, and so that shaped his opinion a lot, right? Like, I kind of know what he's told me on that show, and people can go listen to the Athletic Hockey Show if they want to hear some of that stuff. But I've been sold. I mean, he put JT Miller as the comp in his ranking today. I've also seen somebody who, actually one of our commenters, made the Chris Kreider comp, which I kind of like. And in either of those cases, I think that's a really good player.
Carey Price is of the future. Beware. Okay. For the Anaheim Ducks, I don't know if this is necessarily where they'd go position wise, but I don't think Marco Kasper is going to slip beyond 11. So I really can't pass him up there. They're going to take the likely centerman, Marco Kasper, 10th overall to the Anaheim Ducks. Again, I think he's possibly going to be a Detroit pick. Rogle out of the SHL. Detroit's obviously very intimately familiar with them. And it's a premium position. So he's another player where I'm probably coming in lower than most, and we're going to take a serious look at, because he's in Detroit's range. And again, he seems to have that kind of maturity and that ability to do so much in the game that you need to be able to play center. The production's not blow you away good, but it's also not terrible either. So yeah, Kasper to the Ducks at 10, I think, would be a steal for them. 11th to the San Jose Sharks, Bradley.
I didn't realize how high I was on the forwards in this draft and how low I was on a lot of the defensemen until I keep looking at my board and it's just like forwards. But for San Jose here, I'm going to take what might end up being one of many value picks in this draft for the same reason. And I'm going to go with Danila Yurov.
I really like that pick. I was talking about this with somebody today, and it seems like every few years there's kind of a some reason that Russians are going to fall in the draft. And it seems like every time, 4 years later, people are like, how did that guy fall in the draft? And the answer is always because he's Russian. And this time it is different. This is not just about the KHL. This is about, you know, obviously the political situation with coming out of the invasion in Ukraine, Russia's invasion of Ukraine. And, you know, Russia wasn't at the World Championships for that reason. And, you know, the U18s for that reason. So this does go beyond kind of the usual Russian factor thing. But my guess would just be, I don't know how long it's going to take, but at some time people are going to look back on this draft and say like, oh, why did that Russian guy go so low? And they'll remember, but the team that made the pick will ultimately have gotten a good player because of it.
Yeah. There always is a question about Russians, but land war in Europe seems to be a new,
that's a new one. No doubt. Yeah. No doubt.
We had to create a new thing, a new selection in the drop down.
And I'm not trying to compare that to the previous stuff at all. I just, you know, it's yeah.
It's going to create, but you're right. It's going to create an inefficiency in the draft all the same. And I don't think teams are necessarily wrong to kind of operate in a way that's going to create those inefficiencies, yeah, so to speak.
Yeah. You don't know what the situation is going to be. You don't know what the ripple effects of this are. That creates uncertainty, and you hate, if you're drafting, that's like probably the number one thing you hate is uncertainty of any kind. I get it completely. And it, you know, it's way easier for us to sit here on a podcast and say, you know, oh, you guys are going to let these guys fall and then someone's going to get a guy that they love. But our jobs aren't on the line if we make the pick and the guy never plays in our uniform, right? Like, our jobs aren't on the line. So it's way easier for us to sit here and say that than it will be for the people making those picks.
And obviously it's a very negative subject that could have a lot of negative consequences in the context of the draft, but it could also have the inverse, because I don't know if I know for a fact I'm not the only one who's noticed it, because a few people have pointed on Twitter. A lot of Russians this year have signed their ELCs way earlier than they normally would, because, you know, maybe they think that's just what's best for their career. Maybe they're like, yeah, it's getting pretty bad back there and we'd like to get the hell out of there. So it's going to be a fascinating dynamic with the draft, because it's a true nobody knows scenario.
Yeah.
Okay. Max, I believe you are up next on the board. Speaking of drafting Russians, the Columbus Blue Jackets, who are going 12th overall, have been known to do that in the first round in the past. Where are you going to go if you are the GM of the Blue Jackets? Not as scary as the real GM.
Yeah, I think it's got to be... well, I guess they did get Juracek earlier. I think I'm going to go with another D, though. I think I'm going to take Minchikov for them and just kind of keep building up that back end that, you know... there's going to be some temptation here to go with another forward. They added a couple of good ones last year in the first round. But I think if you zoom out a little bit, all of a sudden Columbus's decor, if they take Minchikov here, suddenly, I guess you could go look Cale Makar. Maybe I should do that. Am I locked in?
You're not locked in, but you're going to
be frowned upon.
No. Right. It's not frowned upon. It's in a personal affront, because I was going to take look Cale Makar next, but I think you should take whoever is a better player here. You're not locked in.
I should take look Cale Makar. I'm going to do that. My logic was going to be that the defense core with Minchikov would have Boqvist, Kuhlmans, Juracek, Werenski, Minchikov, which is a really impressive young D there. But I think the better play here for Columbus is going to be to add a winger to the centers they already have. Look Cale Makar is one of the better offensive players in this draft. I should pick him for them. That would be the smart thing to do.
Devastating to me if I'm Lou Lamoriello. Because I would have been thrilled with look Cale Makar there. I am tempted in terms of, you know, talent of the player to take Minchikov here. I really like him. But considering the Islanders, it really depends on what they think of either player as viability as a center. I'm stuck between Brad Lambert and Connor Geeky here. I'm going to go with the Lambert connection. Even though I think in real NHL life, they are probably not going to want to take an uncle-nephew with this high of a pick, especially Lou Lamoriello. But this is a podcast. Like you mentioned, Max has no ramifications on real life. So the New York Islanders at 13th overall are going to take Brad Lambert, an interesting but highly skilled player out of Liga, and one that I know a lot of Red Wings fans will have hoped to see at 8th overall. What do you guys think of Brad Lambert? Because he's all over the board.
Brad, you go first.
I don't even know how to phrase it. Philip Zadina syndrome? Like, you see it, you get it, it just doesn't happen. That seems to be the Brad Lambert trademark so far. There is something there. The talent's there. But eventually it has to click. And he's, correct me if I'm wrong, a late 2003 birthday. He's not even a 2004. So he had that extra year to get it going. And he just hasn't. And it's been multiple teams. I don't know. There's a lot of red flags for me here with the production because, you know, it's been years. It had to come at some point. And it hasn't.
I agree. And he gives you those little tastes at the World Juniors every year where you're like, oh, right, you are freaky talented. And I do get that. I have seen those same clips. But this is the type of player that I struggle the most with, is the one where it's like, why aren't you scoring more? Why aren't you doing this more? And like, even like, people could say, hey, Slavkovsky didn't score that much more in the same league, right? And that's not unfair. But I would say he is younger. And he has shown against men at the World Championships and at the Olympics that he can still do it. And I think if you go back and you look at Slavkovsky's ice time pre-Olympics and post-Olympics, I think that tells you a lot of the story, for what was going on there too. And so I have a really hard time with it. The first guy that comes to my mind with Lambert is like a Fabian Lysell, who I think is a good player, is a talented player. And I think there are people in Lysell's draft year who wanted him to go higher than he did. And he ended up going right at the start of the 20s or so, late teens, start of the 20s. And so I guess that's my best guess for Lambert. Like, there's a world here where he's a freak, for sure. But there's also a world where he's just like an Athanasiou. And that's a player that I would struggle to pick in the top half of the first round.
I'm not drawing parallels in terms of draft position. I understand I'm talking about the second round here, the 52nd overall pick. But just last year, the Islanders took a late birthday centerman who used to be highly touted and dropped on a lot of boards in Otto Ratu. And he seems to have done well. So, you know, I'm not drawing a parallel between the players, but just in terms of the way the teams approached that talent and might evaluate the pick. I can see it being possible, but I can't disagree with you guys in terms of how it would be scary. I'm scared of that pick for the Red Wings.
Yes, absolutely. I don't think that's the direction they're going to go. I do, like, you know, I know you said that's not what you're doing, but I do think it's a different equation at 13 and at 52, right? Like, the stakes there are just so different.
Yep. You'd have to know something that other teams don't, essentially.
And you would. You employ his uncle, but, like, you know.
Okay. Brad, for the Winnipeg Jets, who are you bringing in to play with the Jets and possibly, I don't know, work with Trotz in the future? Who knows?
Well, Barry Trotz loves to build from the back end. And as tempted as Winnipeg would be to take a prospect from Winnipeg, they're going to jump to Michigan and take Pavel Minchikov, since I can do that now.
Minchikov, because Max left him on the board. And I agree. I think that's a good pick at 15. Probably one that I should have taken on with my 14th pick. But he's out of Saginaw. So, like you said, played in Michigan. There are still questions with him, right, in terms of his whether he'd come over. But I think those are softened because he has just played in North America. So
he's been in North America for a couple of years. He sat out that entire OHL season that was canceled. He never bothered going back to Russia, even though the season was canceled. He's right. Like, was committed to the OHL the entire time.
Okay, for the new era Vancouver Canucks, Max, who are you selecting at 15th overall?
There's a few guys here who if I was Jim Rutherford, would really like to pick. Obviously, Ivan Merezhchenko, I think, is probably the most talented player left on the board. He's got double uncertainty with his illness and obviously with the Russia situation this year. So I probably going to veer away at this point, but I think that's probably the highest upside pick that you could make here. A couple defensemen, Kevin Korchinski and Leon Bischel. And then there's the guy who I think I'm ultimately going to pick for them, which is Rucker McGroarty from the NTDP. I like McGroarty. The skating is a question, but everything else seems really solid to me. And I think he's going to be a good top nine NHL player who has, I think, a pretty good shot to end up a pretty good top six player. They've got a couple of guys who, you know, JT Miller, we're going to see what happens there. But this would give them some insurance and some depth, and I just like the player. And that's where I'm going to go. He was captain of Team USA's under-18 team, which I think gives you a little bit of bonus bonus points. Maybe it's not what you base the pick on, but I just like the entire package here. Really good shot, really smart player. Only question is the feet. And every year it seems like there's one or two guys who that is the question for, and it just doesn't end up being that big a deal if they have the sense and the and everything else to overcome it.
He was the guy I was waiting on. He was going to be my next pick, and I thought for sure I was going to get him. Not that he'll ever be this good, but I get big Ryan O'Reilly vibes from him. Just kind of that leader who can't really skate but is so solid at everything else. You know there's something there that you can work with.
It's funny that you went with McRorty because, you know, you mentioned the things that are going to cause questions in terms of where he's picked. I think he's a guy who can go closer to 10 or possibly like 20 to 25. I don't know. But how McRorty goes is how Geeky goes in my mind. They have a lot of the same questions. And depending on how people feel about either player, I think you're going to see him maybe in the same range. And I'm going to go with Geeky for the Buffalo Sabres 16th overall. I think he's... I'd be surprised if he made it that far down. And I think the same way McRory is going to go higher as well. But Geeky could make it in the top 10 really easily and nobody would bat an eye. The biggest question is whether he can stick at center. His skating doesn't leave a lot of confidence, but you almost get somewhat of an Anthony Mantha syndrome. Let me know if I'm off base here, where, yeah, he's not the best skater, but once he gets up to speed, he does move down the ice. It's just a matter of how often is he at speed. But you can't deny the talent. You can't deny the ability to generate that offense. The size is there already at 6'3". I think a team that believes in that kind of archetype of a player is going to be salivating at the opportunity to take Connor Geeky.
I can buy that. I don't know that I remember Mantha skating in his draft year. I don't know that I was paying attention. I liked it better as a pro, but in his draft year, I'm guessing it wasn't quite as good as it was as a pro after he had put all that strength on his legs. So I can buy that comp, yeah.
Brad, you're hot and cold. I think a little bit more cold lately on Geeky. Why don't you give me the reason why I'd be wrong to take him here?
I don't think he's super likely to reach that ceiling everybody talks about. His skating and pace are major, major concerns for me. And a lot of the things that separate Mantha from him are, I think Mantha's skating was better at this age, not by leaps and bounds, but better. And the big difference though is Mantha played at pace. He did things quickly on the ice, whatever it was, whether it was a pass at the right time, getting his shot off quickly, you know, getting just to the right spot at the right time. Those were things that made Mantha special. I don't see that in Geeky, at least not to the level that Mantha has. I mean, don't get me wrong. The shot, unreal. The hands, unreal. The hockey IQ, not terrible. Like, I get it, but I just, the overall package doesn't excite me all that much.
And when Mantha was on, when he was engaged, he would win races to pucks, and he could be effective on the forecheck and all that stuff. And I think he can be effective on the forecheck more so because of his size and physicality and awareness and all that stuff. But like, can he go win you a race to a loose puck, like, or separate the way that Mantha would sometimes, picking off a pass at the blue line? That is where I don't know if I see it. And ultimately, if he ends up like a distributing third line center, that's a good player. But, you know, it's all just, you know, context for what do you want here at this pick. And, you know, yeah.
Yeah, it may have been a bit ambitious for me to talk about how Mantha brought it up to speed, but I guess a better way of saying it would be, if a team is drafting him and isn't concerned about the skating, they think that they could get him to that place where you occasionally can find that separation with, you know, the buildup and
And Buffalo could use a center. Like, positionally, I think you're on good ground there. Like, you know, they already have Cousins, and, you know, we'll see what Krebs is. If Thompson, obviously, I think is probably going to stick down the middle based on what we've seen. So right. They don't necessarily need him to try to be Mr. Do-It-All there. I think but positionally, it makes sense for them. I think it's the right range for him. I think it's a good pick.
All right. So, we're going to cut it off there for now because we've promised to not have too much fun without Prashant. That is the non-playoff team first 16 picks of the 2022 NHL mock entry draft. We're going to do it again with, once we know the full draft order, and we'll go through this whole thing all over again. But for now, we have the Habs, taking Shane Wright at home. The New Jersey Devils are going to take Logan Cooley. The Arizona Coyotes are going to take Juraj Slafkovský. The Kraken are going to take Simon Nemec. The Flyers will take Savoy. The Blue Jackets, with their pick from Chicago, are going to take David Yurecek. The Sens are going to take Kemmel. And Brad selected for the Red Wings Frank Naser. Max also mentioned Cutter Gauthier as well as a possible pick there. The Sabres will select Cutter Gauthier. The Ducks will take Kasper. Danila Yurov to the Sharks, Lekera Mäki to the Blue Jackets, Lambert to the Islanders, Minchikov to the Jets, McGroarty to the Canucks, and Connor Geeky to the Buffalo Sabres. If you have any thoughts on those picks, we ask you to do two things. Leave a comment or whatever, tweet at us, however you're listening to this podcast. Let us know what you think. And if you really, really disagree to the point where you're angry, tweet at @Iyer_Prashanth and just let him know exactly how mad you are.
Yeah, he would have never let that happen if he was here. Whatever you're mad about, he would have prevented it if he was here.
Exactly right. So that's on him. Max, tell us very quickly about your latest piece for The Athletic Detroit, as well as the show that you do with Corey Proman over at The Athletic.
Yeah, Corey and I do the Friday episode of the Athletic Hockey Show, which is an everyday show. Kind of every day has a little bit of a different flavor to it. Like, Ian Mendez and Haley Salvian usually have the Monday show. Craig Custance and Sean Gentile have the Tuesday show, which usually is centered around an interview with a really interesting NHL or hockey in general person. The Wednesday show, I think, is the one that Rob Pizzo hosts with Jesse Granger and Sarah Sivian. And I think Julie McKenzie's on that one a lot, right? And then the Thursday show is Down Goes Brown and Ian, which obviously if you read Down Goes Brown, you can kind of imagine how that one is really fun too. And I think Jesse does a segment on that show a lot. But Corey and I's is the Friday, and we hone in on prospects. Obviously, Corey is the brains there, but it's very fun for me to do because there's a lot of overlap on my beat, obviously, covering the Red Wings and the prospects. It helps me learn more about those guys and all that stuff. So it's a fun show. I think people should check it out. Corey is a wealth of information. And if you like his work written, I think you really enjoy hearing a little bit of what goes into all of that. And he often will drop in little tidbits that he hears from NHL people, about these guys that I don't usually ever see make it to print. So I think it's a really useful kind of supplement for people to hear some of those extra stuff. Story that I've got coming this week, hopefully, unless there's a catastrophe, is every year I do a what one thing the Red Wings can learn from each conference finalist is. I will spoil one for you guys. One of them is about Mike Smith, and it is a bad situation for me tonight. I'll also give you guys an update. Edmonton just scored to make it 7-5, so we are approaching that over total. I don't think we're going to hit it, but we'll see. But yeah, really would appreciate anybody who wants to subscribe to The Athletic and read what we do. I'll be at the Combine this week with some fun stories, hopefully, to come out of that. Thanks for letting me ramble.
Yeah, and Max, just, I mean, you didn't ask for it, but some advice. If the Mike Smith story fails, you can just default to the draft Connor McDavid advice for that
one. It's in their story. Like, it's like, I should say this, but I feel like I have to pick something different. And I ended up picking that, like, you can win with an unorthodox goalie. And you know what? Like, coming into this game, Mike Smith was riding a .927 save percentage in these playoffs, even with the crazy gaffes that we've all seen. Shesterkin was at a .928. There was a statistical basis for it, but damn it if he didn't give up 6 goals just a couple hours after I filed it. So we'll see how that goes.
Don't give it up yet, man. We all saw how that Calgary series went. Folks, this has been the first mock draft of the Winged Wheel podcast. Max, thank you for joining. Max Bultman with The Athletic Detroit. Go subscribe, and until next time. All right, that was our first mock draft. Like Brad said earlier, for the picks you liked, you're welcome. For the picks you hated, @HockeytownEvan on Twitter. So thank you, Max, for joining us, and hope you all enjoyed our first mock draft of the season. As the playoffs roll on and as the prospect conversations continue, we will do more mock drafts and a full rounds worth of them.
Apparently, I have a type because I think my first 3 picks added up to like 212 pounds.
Oh, you drafted 3 of you?
Pretty much, yeah.
Before we jump into what's going to be I can only assume amazing conversation about an offside review, I first want to tell you that this episode of the Winged Wheel podcast is proudly brought to you by the FanDuel Sportsbook, sponsor that gives hockey fans what we really need, even more excitement in the game. There's so many reasons why FanDuel is America's number one sportsbook. They're simple to use with great odds on different betting markets, giving you more action every game day. Plus, they're tons of fun with unique bet types like same game parlay and exclusive promos on the biggest events. And when you win, you get your winnings safely in as little as 24 hours. Now listen to this. FanDuel is letting you place your first bet risk-free up to $1,000. Just place a bet on any game and FanDuel will refund you up to $1,000 back if you don't win that first bet. If you win, you keep the cash. If you lose, you get up to $1,000 back in site credit. Download the FanDuel Sportsbook app to get started with that risk-free bet of up to $1,000 and be sure to sign up with promo code WWP so they know the Winged Wheel podcast sent you. That's FanDuel Sportsbook promo code WWP. Must be 21 and older and present in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, West Virginia, Indiana, Colorado, Iowa, Tennessee, Virginia, or Michigan. First online real money wager only. Site credit is non-withdrawable and expires in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See sportsbook.fanduel.com for details. If you have a gambling problem, call 1-800-522-4700 in Colorado, 1-800-BETS-OFF in Iowa, 1-800-9-WITH-IT in Indiana, 1-800-GAMBLER in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, or Virginia, Tennessee Redline 1-800-889-9789, 1-800-GAMBLER.net in West Virginia, or call 1-800-270-7117 in Michigan.
Brad, an offside review was controversial. Can you believe it? Why wouldn't you, as the Winged Wheel podcast host with the most to say about reviews, ever warn us about the danger of offside reviews? I blame you. I blame you for my naivety in thinking these would be a good thing and that nothing would ever go wrong with them. Shame on you, Brad. You have a responsibility to the public and you failed us. You failed your co-hosts. And Evan's not here, but I know he's disappointed in you. Everyone join me in booing Brad. Tweet at Hockeytown Evan and just say boo. No, seriously, what a mess.
This is what I've been preaching for years in stating that, yeah, in theory, getting everything right and crystal clear is great. Except when has the NHL ever been good at that? And as we're learning with goaltender interference reviews and offside reviews and other seemingly simpler reviews, it never works out that way. And it never will, because the NHL can't stop themselves from being the NHL. Because in this one, the problem wasn't the review itself. It was the actual way the rules are written.
Which I didn't know was a thing, because offsides are literally, well, almost literally about black and white. It's about blue and white. It is. There shouldn't ever be an interpretation based on the spirit of the rule. But as I started talking about people, they started citing the rule book, and I saw lines in the rule book where I was like, whoa, why is that worded like that? Because that absolutely needs clarification, because this should be a technical, you are on this part of the line, you are offside. If you are on this part of the line, you are onside rule. Here's the gist of it. Valerie Nichushkin was coming back onside. Or he had to tag up. He was in the zone. Cale Makar caught the puck outside of the zone, brought it in while stick handling, essentially. The ruling was that the puck crossed the blue line into the offensive zone. And at the very moment as that happened, Cale Makar, while stick handling slash pushing the puck, pushed the puck off of his stick, which it is close. It is extremely close. I have seen an angle where I can buy that. But he pushed the puck off his stick and then only touched it in the zone after Nichushkin's skate tagged up on the blue line and he was thus onside. Here's the thing. There is an interpretation here, which I can't sit here and say is wrong, that says Cale Makar was technically offside because he is either in control or possession of the puck, which part of the rule states that he has to be touching it, but there's other parts of the rules that dictate control slash possession as just it being in your area slash your stick handling it. And there's another argument coming from the same angle that says he is a player who made an attempt to control the puck whilst it was in an offside position. The spirit, the implication of that rule was only ever really meant to apply to players who preceded the puck in the zone. That's the spirit of it, but that's not written in the rule book, which I was shocked by. So all of that needs to be addressed, and then you need to get into the conversation of, was that genuinely a push forward by Makar where he did that thing where we sometimes see by players who are about to be offside where they lift their stick off the puck or they shovel it forward intentionally? Because it was, I would edge towards, he was actually just stick handling it and he got lucky more than anything. So there is a mess here. There are a lot of different angles. Everyone is right and everyone's wrong.
Yeah. Doesn't this feel like the most NHL thing ever?
How do you not have that sorted out?
It's terrible. So this is where there's one part of this where I think the offside reviews themselves are hurting the NHL here. It's because...
Can I just say...
This is Pavlov's review. We see foot
white space, blue line, puck, white space, blue line. He's offside. Clear as day. Offside. Because we're so used to two players entering the zone and seeing a freeze frame of that exact moment and going offside.
Yeah,
yeah. So we see that and we go offside.
Somewhere there's a psychologist listening to this dying inside by the probable misuse of Pavlov's.
Oh, it's absolutely wrong. I don't care.
But I know what you mean and I completely agree.
Yeah, yeah. We're trained to see foot, white space, blue line, puck, white space, blue line, offside. And that's what everybody was basing their opinion on, primarily from what I've seen. But again, you're right in the sense that it's hilarious how poorly this rule is written. So the way I took this play particular was by basing it up against every other tag up offside scenario we have seen in hockey for a million years. The only reason that it feels weird is because 99 out of 100 times they don't end up in a goal. Because how many times have we seen a scenario where a player will be offside, his teammates are waiting for him to tag up, and the puck's like a foot inside the blue line, and the attacker, he's sitting there staring at it, waiting for his teammate to tag up, and then as soon as that foot hits the blue line, he grabs it and goes. You can argue he's definitely not in possession of the puck when he's doing that because he's sitting there waiting, but they don't blow the whistle till he touches the puck. On any given tag up offside where a guy's chasing the puck around the zone, even if his teammate's offside and the ref's got his arm up and he's yelling offside, 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 they don't blow it till he touches it. Most of the time, unless the ref is certain, buddy, doesn't hear him and is ignoring him. But on a normal tag up offside, they will not blow it until he touches it.
No, but by the rules, if they're chasing, if they know they're in offside position.
And if the ref deems, he's like, okay, no, screw this guy.
Yeah. You know, it's kind of like in soccer. Yeah. And if you're over the pond football, where if they try to influence the play at all, if they're part of the play, then they'll rule that offside. But I know what you mean.
It doesn't apply to this particular circumstance.
For the tag up situation, it's touching the puck.
Yeah. So this is not a situation of them entering the zone where the puck preceding the skate matters. It doesn't in this instance, because on a normal tag up offside, it doesn't get blown until contact is made with the puck. So by the best interpretation of this that we can come up with based on the horribly written rules, I think they got it right. But the fact that I have to say, I think about something that's supposed to be so simple is hilarious to me. And the NHL constantly dumping all over themselves because of their terrible rules actually fills me with great joy. But I'm also very, very tired of this.
Rule 83.3. If during the course of the delayed offside, any member of the attacking team touches the puck, attempts to gain possession of a loose puck, et cetera, the linesman shall stop the play for the offside violation. Like I said, as long as I have known, refereed, and played hockey, watched hockey, that rule is only ever applied to a player who had preceded the puck into the zone and was more or less the cause of being in the offside position.
Mm-hmm.
Not players like in Cale Makar's position, but as that rule is written, then it should have been deemed offside. Also, you know, does there need to be something in there to distinguish? Like, are you okay with the simple touching of the puck? Because there's a difference between a player who lifts a stick and doesn't put it down on the puck until he knows his teammates have tagged up versus Cale Makar, who I legitimately believe was just in between stick handles.
Oh, 1,000% was just in
between. He got lucky,
in between stick handles.
But and that was still close. I saw one angle like 2 hours ago where I was like, okay, I can see that he probably didn't touch it.
Yeah, which whatever. It was the same thing as the Coleman thing. It was lucky here more than anything because he was in the process of just stick handling. But again, the interpretation of the rule, Makar didn't have time to decide whether or not he was going to, quote unquote, attempt to play the puck on the tag up offside, because A, he didn't know Nichushkin was offside. So you can't make a call based on an attempt because he didn't know. And B, because it was such a short amount of time, Given the fact that this is what actually happened, you can very much argue, well, he didn't have time to actually play the puck, so how could he call in an attempt? He literally stick handled and Nichushkin was out in time. Right? So that's why I think the closest interpretation of the rule you have to go by is the traditional tag up of when does he actually touch the puck?
And then there's the whole conversation of a player who comes in backwards with the puck in control.
Oh, don't even get me started on that shit.
Is deemed onside. So, you know, then you're like, why is that the standard for control versus not? Then everything goes out the window. And then you're like, what counts as backward? Does sideways count as backwards? Does there have to be? It's the NHL genuinely does. As the game gets faster and they get more Cale Makars, and as teams know that they can exploit these kind of edge cases, which will be hard to do, but still, they will need to clarify this codified and clearly.
Remember that Patreon exclusive episode where we had to come up with our craziest ideas to how to make hockey better, and just to see the chaotic reaction, I suggested just ban off, like get rid of offsides entirely, get rid of the blue lines. I'm getting there, man. Honestly.
This is not just mine, not just yours, all hockey fans' collective Joker origin story.
Oh,
we're getting there.
It was a sick goal. It was, what a shot.
We're not even talking about that.
I hate this league so. And the thing is too, here's where the review part of this bothers me. Because unless the league fixes the way they rate the rules, what are the point of reviews? Because how many times in the last 3 weeks have we went to review to get something quote unquote definitively correct? And it just adds more confusion. A play like this in previous years would go, half the fans would be yelling, oh, that ref screwed up, and then forget about it the next morning. Because, ah, shit, ref made a bad call, happens a million times. Yeah, whatever. But the review just makes it that much worse, because now it's another chain in the link, another link in the chain of people going, well, now this guy also screwed up, and the entire league screwed up. How can they keep screwing this up?
And NHL just goes, oh, no.
Well, figure it out.
The funny thing is there's a link to some example videos that I think were used for either rule book or officiating clarification, which is a common practice, where Charlie McAvoy, for example, intentionally pushes the puck forward a foot off of his stick, waits for the tag up behind him, and then touches it essentially right after. By rule, like if someone were to hit Charlie McAvoy, that would be a clean hit because he would be in possession of the puck. But by rule or in practice of the offside, he wasn't touching it. So there's, like you said, there's all these little.
Yeah, and that's probably the I think that one specifically, because that was against Vancouver, yes?
I believe so.
Yeah, because I think I saw that clip, and that's probably the best.
Yeah, Vancouver.
That was probably the best precedent for this play, because nothing about it was accidental, but it was still fine. Right?
I think
the clarification on this rule, and I know it's not how it's written now, but I think that the way these two plays played out is probably the way the rule should be written, but it should be written that way because it's as close to black and white as you can get. Buddy's off, everything's fine until stick touches puck because it's a definitive stick touches puck. There's no intent. There's no, is he in control of the puck? Just no. Okay. You are free and clear until your stick touches the puck. Now you're offside.
Yeah. My preference is that if and likely when now they fix this, they make it so it is certain that he was onside.
Yeah.
Well, let's hope that's the last time we ever talk about an offside review.
I'm going to open my phone in 5 minutes just to see whatever controversial call happened in Tampa, New York right now.
So it's a good time to transition. Tampa, New York, which means New York broke Carolina's streak of all those wins at home. They ended up winning game 7 in decisive manner. Shesterkin is Shesterkin, and currently their award is game 1 of the Eastern Conference Final against the twice defending Stanley Cup champion. Your thoughts on Carolina not getting it done?
I hate this because Carolina is good, and I'm about to sell a few of their players short, even though I shouldn't, but
there's another short joke in here, and I remain not clever enough.
Okay. I tried to think of one for you. I didn't get it either. Anyways.
We're nothing without Evan.
Yeah. So one of the big talking points for the Red Wings through the rebuild is, what's the best path to get good again? And one of the points I know I was always very adamant about and always gravitated towards is, this is a superstar-driven league. You need stars. Doesn't matter how deep you are,
Any team can shut down any player every game. You need that star who can break through. Carolina really doesn't have that player, and it showed because they played great. They, by and large, outplayed the Rangers in that series, I'd say comfortably. Obviously, Shesterkin had a lot to do with that, but there were a lot of times it just didn't feel like Carolina was really threatening despite controlling the game. Even in that was a game five where they absolutely handled the Rangers. Didn't feel like they were killing them like you've seen Colorado, Tampa.
Right.
Right, you know what I mean? And as good as Svechnikov is, as good as Aho is, as good as Slavin is, as good as a lot of their players are, they're not Panarin, Zibanejad. Their goalie's not Shesterkin. They don't have a Kucherov. They don't have a McKinnon. They don't have a McDavid. They don't have those guys who just make that difference when you need it most. So despite the fact they are a very deep, very good team, when it gets to crunch time and you're playing a team like the Rangers, who by and large are a weaker, inferior team, but they throw the absolute clamps on and they ran the intensity up to 110 and they've got a good goalie, Carolina just didn't have those big guns to overcome it.
It's, I think, a version of the Rangers that didn't have a star goaltender might have, I think Carolina might have been able to get it done, but that's the playoffs, right?
But even in game seven, that game wasn't close.
No, but I think it would have made the difference maybe in some other games. But even then, Carolina, this is all like a longer way to get to your main point. Carolina would have run into Tampa Bay the next round in Vasilevsky. Exactly. Yeah. You need to find a way to get that done. We did get word of, you know, every team dumps their injury report where it turns out like seven of the players were legally dead. Frederick Anderson has a torn MCL, which like
that would have helped because Ranta wasn't bad, but he wasn't great.
And you can only expect they got more than they could have ever hoped for with Kotchikov. So it's tough. Okay. I know we've played game one. We had like about 85 goals. We joked on that interview. We set the over under at 13. What was it? 13.5.
Yeah.
And we hit 14. We hit the over for that game.
Somehow.
Mayhem. Pure chaos. An 8-6 final in game one of the Western Conference final between Colorado and Edmonton. With that in hand and knowing that the Rangers and the Lightning are about to go into the first intermission tied 1-1, what are your predictions?
Boring answers. Hard to pick against Colorado and Tampa here. I mean, the Rangers had the advantage over everybody they've played so far this year, from one standpoint at least. They had Shesterkin. He was definitively better than Carolina and Pittsburgh's backups, and nobody could argue it. Is he better than playoff Vasilevsky? Maybe, maybe not. Probably not. Are the Rangers as a team better than Tampa as a team? Absolutely not. No chance. This is going to have to be... Remember how I was talking about Tampa doesn't take a shift off?
Yeah.
They're not going to take a shift off. They're not going to fold. The Rangers, the only way they win the series is they have to go out, punch above their weight class at forward and defense, and match their intensity, and hope Shesterkin outduels Vasilevsky. And I don't see all of that happening. I could see one or two of those things happening, but I don't think one or two of those things equals a Rangers series win.
I think the Rangers have enough in place where if the right players do the right things, they could do it, but I'll agree that it's unlikely. Shesterkin could goalie them. Yes, it's Tampa Bay, and yes, they have a Vasilevsky, but Shesterkin is one of the only goalies on the planet who you could say could go toe-to-toe with Vasilevsky and goalie the other team. It's not likely. And they would need a lot to go their way, and they need Tampa Bay to not do a lot of things that Tampa Bay tends to do. I could see it happening. I'm still going to take Tampa Bay here. In the West, I know earlier I said I'm not going to bet against Connor McDavid, and so in the spirit of keeping it fair, I'll continue that. But the only way Edmonton wins is in seven, because there's absolutely no way they're going to... Colorado's not Calgary. I feel like Colorado has a more potent offense that is going to expose, like we saw, the Edmonton defense and their goaltending. But then again, Mike Smith is either the second coming of Patrick Waugh or Mike Smith. There's no in-between for him. So just to keep it honest, because I said it before, I'm not going to bet against McDavid. Oilers in seven, but I'm pretty confident I'm going to be wrong on that one.
I've said I have a real hard time betting against Connor McDavid. and this is hard, but I'm betting against Connor McDavid because superstar driven league. Edmonton's got two of them. Colorado's got four. It's Edmonton put up six in a game. Connor McDavid threw 3 points at him. Colorado won. Hard, hard to bet against them. I think this series is going to be super close. I think this series is going to go super deep. But when you have McKinnon, Landeskog, Rantanen, Makar, hell, I said four. You could almost this season put Devontae and Nazem Kadri into that as well.
Yeah.
I just can't bet against that.
Okay. Well, I think we've run long here, so why don't we jump into overtime and take some questions from Patreon. This is a midweek episode, so it's Patreon exclusive. Our Patreon supporters are the reason we're able to run this show, especially during the Red Wings offseason, give you the kind of draft preview and content that you all want, and essentially do our best to survive without Evan. Hopefully he's back next episode, but it's a maybe. But no, seriously, patreon.com/wingedwheelpodcast if you want to join the Dub Dub Club, and we can't say enough how much we appreciate all of you.
He fell in the Jackson hole.
He went out. It's like looking for the lost city of, what's the one with the gold? El Dorado. I was stuck between Atlantis and El Dorado, and I went with El Dorado, and I just didn't have it in front of me. Okay, we're going to take questions from our Patreon supporters, some of them, and then the rest will be on our Patreon exclusive full overtime where we go completely unhinged, and Brad gets to do some swear words. So,
and I'm sleep-deprived today, so I'll either say nothing or it could go really off the rails, and I'd say equally likely.
This is an interesting comment from Josh Brink, which I think is funny. Through three rounds, the total goals scored in each team's opening games. Edmonton, 36, three games. Colorado, 28, three games. Tampa Bay, 10 in two games. And the New York Rangers, 10 in two games. So that's before today's game one in the East. No matter what, we get an offense versus defense finals. He's not wrong.
For the good of hockey, we've got to hope whoever wins the Western Conference wins.
There may be a world where we have to, where people rooting for the team out of the West has to bank on Mike Smith winning the Stanley Cup as the starting goalie.
We as Red Wings fans might experience hell. Think about it. We might have to choose between Colorado and Tampa Bay.
I know.
Do you know how much I hate that statement?
And then honestly, with Edmonton, if Connor McDavid's his way to a cup, we're going to have to hear so much of a Ken Holland, you know, built a cup winning team narrative.
Fine. If it prevents us from Tampa or Colorado, fine. Fully on board. Hey, I like Ken Holland as a person.
Yeah, it's great. Sure.
Terrible GM in the last 10 years, but like, great dude. Be happy for him.
I legitimately, the only part of Ken Holland's tenure that I don't like is his last phase with Detroit.
Yeah. I don't, most of what he's done at Edmonton, but he has.
I don't care what he's done at
Edmonton. But he's done the two most important things he could do as the Edmonton Oilers GM. He didn't trade Connor McDavid and he didn't trade Leon Draisaitl. We're happy for people when they win the lottery, right? If your best friend wins the lottery, you're not like, oh, you lucky POS. You're happy for him. If Ken Holland wins the Stanley Cup with the Edmonton Oilers, we're not going to say, oh, you lucky POS. We're happy for him. It's fine. If you get lucky and something good happens, it's fine.
You win the lottery. How much are you giving me percentage-wise?
That's how much I win.
$100 million.
$100 million? I'm going to figure out a way that you owe me $100,000.
That just means I can hire a lawyer for like... That's fair. I've done enough to warrant that. I want to be upset, but yeah.
I'm hiring Johnny Depp's lawyer to sue for emotional damage.
Oh, yeah. Tune into the Patreon exclusive where it's a 6-hour recap of that entire trial. Oh, God. I'm so happy. It's off. It's going to be off the news now.
I did a really good job of barely paying attention to it.
I admire that about you.
Yeah. And it did come up in my feed all the time, but like I just kind of glanced past it. It never caught my attention.
I was shocked when the lawyer pressed the play button on a like recorded clip and it was just the podcast.
Weird.
Yeah.
Funny. I was wondering why our listens went up.
Down, you mean. Bertuzzi's Lost Tooth says, is there a universe where Yzerman signs Namestnikov again? Please say yes.
Yeah. Possible.
Absolutely. It's not entirely likely for players to go back to the team that let them go, but if you had to pick a situation where you'd put it within the realm of possibility, it's Namestnikov, how much he liked Detroit, and the fact that the Red Wings may still be in a phase where they need good but not expensive, great players on the roster next season.
We're also at the point, too, where this team probably wants to move forward. And I don't know if trying to recreate last year's team is the greatest idea. Because there's not going to be a lot of turnover at forward as is.
No, no. Last year's, I mean, like every year's, was mired with injury in certain ways where you're like, you don't really think you got the full picture, but at the same time, you kind of did. Cody Stark says, one of my best friends coached in the USHL from 2019 to 2021, and then in the NCAA last year, coached against Shai Buya many times. One of the best players he's ever coached against, he said. Bodes well. You know, talking,
promising.
Talking about draft picks and those that were some a little bit more projects in terms of their skill sets. I know the Shai Buya pick was a big, okay, if you're that's who you're going with all those other players on the board, that's fine. But you have to hope that this pans out because he is a unique but skilled player and one that does seem to be doing well.
Seems to be a Red Wings trend here. And the two that similar-ish picks of the high upside projects while leaving a lot of good talent on the board seem to be turning out 50-50. The Tuomisto one is leaving a lot to be desired, but the Wallander one seems to be turning out okay. So
if those are anything more than 50-50, then they're not project picks by definition.
Yeah.
They go higher or you have an abnormally good scouting team, yeah. At which point, congratulations, they're all going to be hired out as GMs elsewhere.
But between Buyam, Wallander, and Tuomisto, 3 second-round picks, if you get one top four defenseman out of that, it's a home run.
Yeah, it's a win.
The other two could never play a game in the NHL, but you get one legit top four defenseman. Again, go look at how players turn out in the second round. That would be a phenomenal outcome.
Jacob Charlip says, with Tampa Bay beginning to truly threaten for the three-peat, I'm beginning to wonder whether any of our championship teams were better. Which of the following is best built to beat Tampa in a 7-game series, assuming a healthy Braden Point? 97-98 wings, 02 wings, or 08 wings?
Oh, I consider the 2002 Detroit Red Wings to be the single greatest hockey team of all time. So I will go with that one.
In the NHL. Yeah, you have to look at the Olympics.
Yeah, that's fair. I was going to be like, oh, well, they had a lot of Olympians on it. But yeah, no, that's probably true.
Unfortunately, I do agree with you, Brad. Like, that is... I don't think we'll ever see a team like that again unless one day the NHL just says F it and just gets rid of the salary cap.
Because there's what, already 10 Hall of Famers from that team?
And, 10, 11, yeah.
And Datsyuk hasn't even gone in yet?
There's, you don't think about Scotty Bowman as coach either. They essentially just brought in the Monstars to play in the 0-2 playoffs. Like, oh, the third pairing has another Hall of Famer on there. Or, oh, the fourth line has another Hall of Famer. Pavel, the two
the
kids...
The fourth line had arguably the greatest left winger in hockey history, not named Alex Ovechkin.
You're not kidding.
Like, that's a very literal statement.
Brad is not kidding. Luke Robitaille was on that fourth line. You had the two kids in an old goat line.
Yeah, Pavel Datsyuk and Brett Hull were on the third line.
I could watch those highlights from that game 7 repeatedly. Oh, yeah. I would say that 0-2 team could go toe to toe. If you want to start comparing eras and speed and clutch and grab versus not, then that's a different conversation. But I think you just measure and put those eras on level standing, then that's where you get. All right. We're going to wrap up this episode. I know we've run long. For those of you who are still with us, if any of you are on social media other than Twitter, check us out on Instagram or TikTok. We're on both of those things now. YouTube as well. So we'll post clips and reels and things like that on those. So if you want to go give us a follow on anything that you spend your time mindlessly scrolling on, like Brad and I. And thank you all so much for your support. For those of you who have left ratings on iTunes or Spotify or wherever you listen to your podcast, it makes a huge, huge difference for us. Even if you don't, but you have those services, go give us a rating and it would make a big, big difference if that's something that you want to do. We really appreciate it. Thank you all so much for listening. Thank you to our sponsors, the FanDuel Sportsbook, all of our patrons and our name level supporters on Patreon, Arjun Shankar, Yves Bartels on behalf of the Sarah Grand Foundation, Ake for the Stay Fresh Cheese Bag, Nick Perks, Brett Bailey, Terry Driver of the number 69, Crying Ryan Hanna's Banana Slam Pajamathong, Matthew M. Rice, Bettman Should Lose His Job Based on the Oaths Changed My Mind, Brandon M., Carl Brutanen Nanaluski, Chimmy, Chumbawamba Not Chumbawamba, Citizen High Five, Coyote Season Tickets in Tempe, Craig Kibble, Derek Enstam, DJ Denton, Doesn't Tuesn It, Give Blood Fight Probert, Greach, Hassam Al-Kassem, I Leave My Wife for Cider, Jay Gollum, Jacob Turner, Kalen Wood, King Tone, Kyle Hashman, Marcus, Matt McKay, Nicholas Fritz, R.A., Ryan Hubbard, Scott Martin, Sean Levine, Stay Fresh Cheesebags, Zach Spring, Sam Bankson, Stay Fresh Cheesebags, Adam, Now I Finish Better Than Ernie, Antonio Gracias, Babe Landeskog, Ben Barron, Connor Leighton, Dave W., Eric, The Eric Sinkowski, Evans Parking Garage, Evans Bingo Card, James Laporte, Jeremiah Dobo, Jeremy Brocker, J.M. Rhapsody, John Evans, Josh Yelton, Justin and the Angry Mob, Kevin McCracken, Quaz, Matt Keeler, Matt S., Maximilian Cheesebags, Papa Woody, Professor Balzac, Puck Norris, Revy DeLuca, Trevor Pevovar, Wish.com, Shea Weber, Zach Handyside, and Zach McCann, a driving range superstar. Thank you all so much. We're going to go try to find Evan.
Thanks for tuning in to the Winged Wheel Podcast. Be sure to check out wingedwheelpodcast.com, where you can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. You'll also find links to other ways to support the show, such as Patreon, official podcast apparel, and more. And don't forget to follow the show on Twitter at Winged Wheel Pod. And of course, the hosts at Brad Crisco, at Ryan Hanna WWP, and at Hockeytown Evan.